How's it going, everyone? I'm Scott Moss, and welcome to API Design with Node.js V4. I created this course because I love building APIs in Node.js, but also because it's such a practical skill to have, with Node.js being one of the most popular frameworks out there. In this course, we'll learn how to design and build API routes and middleware using Node and Express, interacting with a Postgres database with Prisma and TypeScript, and then locking down routes using JSON web tokens. And finally, how to deploy your API for the world to see. I had so much fun developing the course, and I really hope you enjoy too. Now what we want to do is we want to say app.use. We never talked about that. Use is not a HTTP method, but it's something built into Express. And use allows you to apply some type of global option, some type of global configuration, either to the whole app or to a certain path of your API. In our case, we're gonna do a certain path. We're gonna say we wanna use, or so for everything that has slash API in it, we wanna use the router. So what is this actually saying? Okay, we're gonna walk through it. We know in our router we have a route, let's say, we know we have a GET request for GET slash product, right? So in our head, we're like, oh, cool. If we want to make a GET request to slash product, assuming there was something here, it would trigger this. It would work. No, not anymore, because router is mounted to slash API. So the actual URL for that would be slash API slash product, because this is mounted before any other routes that are registered here. So now this whole router doesn't exist until you put slash API in your URL. So you have to go to your URL, .com/API/any one of these. But these don't know that they belong to slash API. And that's what makes router cool. It's just a way for you to abstract and move around different pieces of your API, like components. You can think of like a router as like a component for routes, basically. They're just reusable. I'm going to introduce you to a really cool VS Code plugin, so we don't have to use the browser anymore. If you're using VS Code, that is. If you're not, what are you using? And let me know why, because maybe it's better. I don't know. But VS Code plugin is called Thunder Client. Highly recommend downloading it. In fact, I'm encouraging you to download it for this course. I will be using it exclusively to test out our API calls. Thunder Client is just like any other HTTP GUI. It's just a place where you can go test out API calls. We can only go so far in the browser because the browser only allows you to do GET requests when you hit enter in the URL. What if you don't do a put or a delete or a post or a patch? You can't. You gotta write JavaScript for that. Who wants to write JavaScript for that? We should be able to click on things. Okay, Thunder Client lets us click on things. So I'm gonna go in here. I'm going to, you can make a new request. I'm gonna do a GET request to my localhost, my port, slash API, slash product, okay? I got some other stuff in here. Don't worry about this. We'll get to that later. I don't want anything in the body because it's a GET request. I'm not sending anything. And I'm going to run this, but we're going to run into a problem. So make sure your server's on. I'm going to hit that. So right now, you can see that it just says processing, 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 okay? This should not happen. Okay, it's not Thunder Client that's broken. It's my API. My API is doing what's called hanging. It's the equivalent of you trying to call someone and they just don't pick up. Or no, actually, I think it's more like they did pick up, but then they didn't say anything. They just like, you could just hear them breathing on the phone, but they don't actually say anything. And then eventually you get tired of it and you hang up. That's what's happening right now. So our server picked up, it's like, yo, I got you. And then it just continued to just mouth breathe on the phone like forever. And then you couldn't actually understand what they were saying. So we need to fix that. So what I'm gonna do is just go into our code. Okay, there we go. I forgot this thing was in here. And for the product one, I'm just gonna just put something in here. I'm gonna say request response. And I'm just gonna say response.json. So I'll put a message in here, hello, like that. You can send back whatever you want. I'm just gonna send back something here for the GET on the product. I'm gonna send back hello. I'm gonna hit save. This thing isn't auto restarting, so I'm gonna have to stop it and start it again. I'm going to go back into Thunder Client. And then now go to issue the request. And then you can see immediately I got something back. Status 200, 19 bytes, 15 milliseconds. So our API route is working. We can go to /API/product, and it works. And then now we're going to make our own middleware. So let's just make one for fun. You can follow along and make one that I'm making, or you can just make your own and have it do anything you want, because we're probably just going to erase it anyway. It's not practical, but I want you to get into the feeling of making something. So I'm going to say app.use here, and I'm just going to make my middleware right inside of here like this. And I'm going to say request, response, next. Okay. What I'm going to do is I'm going to augment the request object. So I'm going to say, ooh, rec.secret equals doggy. Okay? So I'm adding something to the request object. And then I'm saying, yeah, next. Go next. Right? So any single request that's registered after this middleware is registered will now have access to rec.secret. So I should be able to go into, I'm going to go all the way into my router. I'm going to go into this /product one. And I'm going to send back, instead of hello, I'm going to send back rec.secret, like that. Because this should have access to it, because this came after me registering my middleware. So I should have it. Let's see. So I'm going to stop my server, start it again, go back here, run this code, and there you go. I get back doggy. So my middleware augmented the request object. It attached some new information to it. And because the handler that I was logging that information was registered after the middleware, it benefited from this middleware happening first. So if I were to put a log in this middleware and then put a log in the handler, you would see that the middleware would log first because it was written first. Or it was attached to the app first, not written first. But yeah, it was registered first. So yeah, you can make your middleware do whatever you want. And just to show an example of how a middleware can stop the execution of something. Instead of doing that, I can just say, I can just not say next, and I can just be like, you know what? No, I'm just going to stop you right now. Status is 401. Res dot send. Nope. I can just do that. I don't even need the secret thing anymore because it's not even useful. And now it doesn't matter what request I make; it's always going to 401 and say nope. No matter what URL I put in, it's always going to happen. So I can go here, and it literally doesn't matter. I can run this, and it's going to say for unauthorized nope. I believe I can even put anything here, and it would say the same thing. Right? It doesn't matter because it's always doing it. It never goes to. I never call next. I never move on to the next thing, and because this is registered before any other route is registered, none of the routes even get considered because I'm immediately ending the response or the request right here in this middleware. And this middleware is registered globally at the top. So it's pretty powerful. You can do some pretty powerful stuff in middleware. So we got get one product, we got get many products. Let's do create a product. So create product. Same thing, request, response. And this one's pretty simple. So we can say product equals await Prisma dot product dot create. Instead of having a where field, because we're not searching for anything, we have to tell Prisma what data we're giving it to create something. So it's called data instead of where. And the data that we want to create, if we go back and look at our routes for creating a product, it's only going to be a body. That's it. Or I'm sorry, a name on the body. Like, that's it. There's nothing else here. But a product also needs a belongs to. We just don't get that from the user. that's going to be on rec.user. So we'll say data name is rec.body.name. And that's the brilliance of those inputs, is that like now we know 100% sure that rec.body.name is there, because if it wasn't, this handler would never run, because our input validation middleware would have saw that and sent back an error message before we got here. So it just makes having that middleware allows your handlers to just flow very easily, and you can just safely assume that all the things are there, which is great. So you can see I'm still getting this, because it's like, hey, you have a name or whatever, but like, you know, you might need something else. So we got name. Now we need belongs to. So there's a couple ways you can do this. So you can say belongs to, and then you can just put the ID yourself. So you can say rec.user.id, and that works when it comes to relationships. The other way you can do it is, I'm sorry, that would be belongs to ID. There we go. The other way you can do it is if you wanted to do belongs to instead of belongs to ID, and you had the actual user, which we don't, but if we did, you could say belongs to, and then I believe you can do something like associate or match. Ah, there's a keyword here. Ah, maybe it's not worth it. Yeah, just do belongs to ID. That's the preferred way. But there's another way to do it. Just almost never had to. So there we go. We got that. We got the ID. We got the name. Should get a product back. We're just going to be naive here. And res.json, that data with the product. Okay, so let's add that. Let's get rid of this generic one here. And we'll say create product. There we go. Create product. So just look at this. Look at this chain right here. So on a post to slash product, check to see that they actually posted a body object with the name field on it, that's a string, and then check to make sure that that's true, and then run the handler, right? And don't forget that there's an authentication middleware running in front of all of these on server here. So all that's happening before it gets to the handler. And when it finally gets to the handler, we can just focus on the business logic. Okay, let's try that. I'm gonna run that, and I'm gonna go to Thunder client here. I'm just gonna say post to API product. I have my bearer. So if I try to post right now with nothing in the body, let's just see what happens. Obviously we can't, that fails the validation of the input. Just checking to see if that works. But now we can say, oh yeah, I do want a name. And my product's gonna be called, note stuff app. So I can send that up, and voila, I get back a product. I created a product in the database. I put everything on the data field, so it looks nice, and you can see here's the product's ID, it was created at, here's the name of it, and here's who it belongs to, right? And if you wanted to visualize that, again, you can do the NPX Prisma Studio, and you can go back here, and you'll see there's a product in the database.